السلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته. الحمد لله، الحمد لله حمدا كثيرا طيبا مباركا فيه كما يحب ربنا ويرضى جل جلاله وعم نواله، والصلاة والسلام على سيدنا الحبيب المصطفى وعلى آله وأصحابه نجوم الهدى قارة التقى. أما بعد، فأعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم، بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. قال الله تبارك وتعالى في القرآن المجيد: ورفعنا لك ذكرك، صدق الله العظيم. وقال النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم: إذا تكفى همك وتغفر ذنبك، أو كما قال عليه الصلاة والسلام. My respected elders, brothers, mothers and sisters, we had just started a discussion last week regarding the love of the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم and our rights that we owe to the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم being the messenger of Allah. Insan, human being, you and I, our human nature is we look for guidance from others. We look for someone who we can look up to, a role model, a guide in life, who we can act according to, who we imitate. Everyone tries to imitate someone. You see, the youth today, they have a certain style of dressing, certain style of talking, certain style of walking. And it is due to their admiration, they admire certain individuals, they look up to certain individuals, and this influences them to walk in a certain way, to talk in a certain way, to behave in a certain way. To behave in a certain way, especially in public, especially when people have their eyes on them and their ears on them, and they're listening to them. They have this image that they want to portray to others, that imitates the image of those individuals who they look up to. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala tells you and I in the Quran that if you truly love Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, then you have to love the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. It is impossible for you and I to claim to love Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, our Creator, but we don't love the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. That's impossible. And for a person just to merely claim, but his actions or his appearance or his style of speaking or his style of dressing or his style of conducting himself in front of others, socializing with others, is not according to the sunnah of the Prophet ﷺ, then there is a disconnect here. There is a disconnect. Our claim may be something else, but our actions speak louder than our words. So there will be a disconnect there. A poet says very beautifully, he says, "Ta'asil ilah." وَأَنْتَ تَزْعُمُ حُبَّهُ. You disobey Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, whereas you claim you have love for Allah. هَذَا مَحَالٌ فِي الْقِيَاسِ بَدِيعٌ. This is impossible to understand. We can't comprehend. You claim you have love for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, but at the same time you are disobeying His commands. Then the poet says, لَوْ كَانَ حُبُّكَ صَادِقًا لَأَطَعْتَ. If your love for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala was true, you would have obeyed Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Why? إِنَّ الْمُحِبَّ لِمَنْ يُحِبُّ مُطِيعُ. It is the norm of insan and in the world we see that a person who has inclination, affection, love for someone or something, this individual who has love for somebody becomes obedient to them. This is human nature. You become obedient to that individual whom you possess love for. So for you and I to claim that we love Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, yet our actions are against the commands of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. For us to claim that we love Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, but our actions are against the sunnah of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. The poet says, I don't understand this. This is impossible to believe. Because this is not the norm of a human being's character. So what is love? What is the definition of love? The ulama mentioned, muhabbatun nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Your love for the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. How do we define love for the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam? The Sahaba radiyallahu anhum expressed their love. They showed their love. They physically demonstrated their love for the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And from there, you and I take a lesson. From there, you and I get an understanding of what true love for the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam means. We haven't seen the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. They say, ulama say, the scholars say that there are three reasons why a person is inclined towards another individual. A person feels affection towards another person. Number one, due to physical beauty. Physical beauty. A person is attached to another individual, a husband and a wife, partners. you become attracted to somebody, you have physical love, the appearance, it appeases you, and you feel love and affection towards the individual. Number two, the second reason why a person can possibly feel inclination or love towards someone is due to reasons that logically make sense. Logically, it makes sense. People have virtue. There is a hafiz of the Quran. There is a pious individual that you see in the masjid regularly. You see this individual, you recognize this individual as a friend of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, a waliullah, a hafiz of the Quran, an imam in the masjid, a sheikh somewhere, your parents. Your mind tells you that these are my parents, they have a big favor over me, they've done me a great favor, I owe them my respect and my love. You see a person who is a hafiz al Quran, and you feel to yourself, you think to yourself, this individual has memorized the book of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. I owe this individual a degree of respect. There's a leader in society, you owe them a degree of respect. Your mind tells you that they deserve your respect. And number three, the third category, and the third reason why a person feels inclined towards somebody else is because that individual has a lot of favors over you. So naturally, due to their favors over you, you are attracted to them. You feel affection towards them. You feel empathy towards them. Because they've done you a lot of favors. The ulama mentioned that the Prophet ﷺ, all three of these things can be a different discussion, a different topic. The appearance of the Prophet ﷺ, how beautifully he looked, how Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala made him so beautiful. Hassan bin Thabit radiallahu anhu is a very famous saying of Hassan bin Thabit. He was a poet of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam would regularly seat him, or often seat him, upon his own mimbar, upon the mimbar of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and he would request him to say words of praise, poetry. So in one of his poems, he would say, and he's describing the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, saying that my eyes have never seen anything more beautiful than you. No female has ever given birth, no mother has ever given birth to a child more beautiful than you. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has made you so perfect that it is as if you chose how you wanted to be created. You chose your own physical features, the way you wanted your physical appearance to be. You're so perfect in every aspect that it seems as if Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gave you choice. What color hair do you want? What style of hair do you want? Do you want it straight? Do you want it curly? Somewhat straight, mostly straight, towards the end, a little bit of curl to beautify. That's beauty. How perfect his eyebrows were. How perfect the shape of his forehead was. How beautiful his nose was. Just everything was so perfect. Hassan bin Thabit radiallahu anhu says, it's as if the Prophet was given a choice by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. That's a separate discussion. Aisha radiallahu anha used to say that the women in the time of Yusuf alayhi salam cut their fingers when they saw the beauty of Yusuf alayhi salam. They were amazed, they were shocked. They didn't realize that they cut their fingers. They didn't feel the pain. They didn't realize that they cut their own fingers. Aisha radiallahu anha said, if those same women were to see the Habib, the Prophet sallallahu alayhi salam, perhaps they would take their lives. Never mind cutting their fingers, perhaps they would have taken their lives seeing the beauty of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi salam. Perfect in every manner. But we haven't seen the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam. Physically, we haven't seen him yet. Inshallah, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will allow us, bless us with the opportunity that we see the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam. Ameen. Inshallah ta'ala. But we haven't seen the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam yet. So we don't have that level of love that the Sahaba radiallahu anhu had physically seeing the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam. But the second point, where our mind, your mind, my mind tells you and I that the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam deserves your love and deserves my love. Because the favors that the Prophet ﷺ has over you and I are great. We can't numerate, we can't count, we can't collect the favors of the Prophet ﷺ over you and I. So the ulama mentioned that muhabbatun nabiyyu sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, the love for the Prophet ﷺ is defined. How can you and I identify, measure our love for the Prophet ﷺ? The scholars mentioned that the love of the Prophet ﷺ fills your heart so much, that you are inclined towards the Prophet ﷺ in every step of your life. You are inclined towards the Prophet. As I started in the beginning, my young brother, my young sister, they dress in a certain way, they speak in a certain way. Why? Because they admire a certain individual. They are inclined towards them, they are pulled towards them. There's a magnet pulling them towards that individual. The ulama mentioned, your love for the Prophet ﷺ, my love for the Prophet ﷺ will be measured. How will it be measured? Is my heart filled enough with the love of the Prophet ﷺ that when I speak, I want to speak like the Prophet ﷺ? When I walk, I want to walk like the Prophet ﷺ? When I dress, I take pride in dressing like the Prophet ﷺ. I don't feel ashamed to go in public dressing like the Prophet ﷺ. My appearance, do I want my appearance to be like the appearance of the Sahaba radiallahu anhum described the Prophet ﷺ's appearance to be? And it was no coincidence. Let us forget this point. It was no coincidence. The Prophet ﷺ, just because the Prophet ﷺ was from Arabia, that doesn't mean he dressed in a certain way because he was from Arabia. And perhaps if the Prophet ﷺ would have been in a different part of the world, he would have dressed differently. This is the effects of shaitan upon you and I. Everything was selected, was chosen by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala precisely the way Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala wanted it to be. The people of Arabia, the Sahaba radiallahu anhu, were chosen to be the companions of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, not by choice. Not by choice. It was no coincidence that Abu Bakr radiallahu anhu was his friend from childhood. That was not a coincidence. It was no coincidence that a man like Umar radiallahu anhu, whom the people of Mecca feared, whom the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam made dua for, was the man who strengthened Islam to a certain point, Al-Faruq, Alladhi farraqa bayna al-haq wal-batil. He's the one that differentiated between right and wrong. Islam gained strength through him. It was no coincidence that he was the one in Makkah al-Mukarramah when the Prophet ﷺ was preaching. Everything was planned by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in this particular manner. To the extent the appearance of the Prophet ﷺ was also chosen, loved, and the desire of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Don't let anybody trick you into understanding this, into misleading you. Yes, it is a sunnah. There are types of sunnah. Sunnah al-Huda, sunnah al-Zawaid, yes. That's a separate discussion. But it is a sunnah of the Prophet ﷺ, absolutely. But the love of these individuals drive us towards them. Ulama mentioned that the love of the Prophet ﷺ should be so much, our hearts should be filled so much with the love of the Prophet ﷺ, that everything you and I do, we are inclined towards the Messenger sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And if you and I don't know the appearance of the Prophet ﷺ, how the Prophet ﷺ walked, how he spoke, how he ate, how he dressed, what his likes were, what he preferred. If you and I don't know these things, it is time you and I check. We measure ourselves. We measure ourselves. Do we fall under this category of those who are instructed to love the Prophet ﷺ? قُلْ إِن كُنْتُمْ تُحِبُّونَ اللَّهِ. There is only one way to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. There is only one way to the love of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and that is through the love of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. There is no other way. There is no other way. I am not claiming this. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is saying this in the Quran. If you love Allah, then tell them, O Messenger sallallahu alaihi wasallam, fattabi'uni, follow me, follow the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will love you in return if you follow the way of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. My brothers and sisters, there are a lot of rights that the Prophet ﷺ has over us. One such is that we follow him, we obey him in his appearance, in his dress, in his likes, in his wants, in his dislikes, things that he recommended for his ummah, how he strived for his ummah to succeed, how the Sahaba radiallahu anhum displayed their. Amr ibn As radiallahu anhu used to say that there wasn't a single person, there is no single creature alive, no creation of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala alive, that was more beloved to me than the Prophet ﷺ was. And at the same time, there was no one who was more, who struck awe in my eyes, who amazed me, who left me in a state of just amazement and shock and awe than the Prophet ﷺ. To the extent that Amr ibn As radiallahu anhu says, despite the fact that he was the most beloved to me, I did not look at the Prophet ﷺ in a way where I was content by looking at him. Content meaning, like, I was filled, I was enough, and this is enough. I've seen him completely. He further says, Amr ibn As radiallahu anhu, if somebody were to ask me to describe the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam head to toe, I would not be able to. What does he say? If I were asked by anyone, describe the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, how did he look? He says, I wouldn't be able to accurately describe him because I didn't get a full look at him. Allahu Akbar. Despite spending years with him, he says, I didn't get a complete full look where I was content and I thought this is enough. Never. Whenever I was in his presence, my eyes would drop instantly out of respect. Such awe in the presence of the Prophet ﷺ. But this was the love the Sahaba radiallahu anhu had. This was what they had. They sacrificed everything. To come back to my initial point, The love of the Prophet ﷺ will be measured in you and I. Ulama mentioned, your heart should be filled to such an extent, that anything happens in life, any step you take in life, the sunnah, the way of the Prophet ﷺ is what leads you forward. You instantly turn towards the sunnah of the Prophet ﷺ. Your love will be measured according to this. It is impossible for you and I, it is impossible for you and I to claim that we have love for Allah and His Messenger ﷺ and our actions speak differently. The poet says very beautifully, this is impossible to believe. Why? If your love for the Prophet ﷺ, if your love for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala was true, لَأَطَعْتَ, you would obey Him. Because we see in the world a person who, if I have a person who's beloved to me, I am inclined towards that individual, I am obedient to that individual. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala instill our hearts with the love of the Prophet ﷺ. Verily Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, وَرَفَعْنَا لَكَ ذِكْرَكَ. O Messenger, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, I have raised your name, your mention is raised. With us mentioning the Prophet ﷺ, as I mentioned last week, our needs in this world will be fulfilled, and our needs in the hereafter will be fulfilled. There's nowhere else we need to go. There's nothing else we need to do. There's nothing else we need to do. Just turn to the life of the Prophet ﷺ, and by doing so, inshallah ta'ala, we will have the love of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. If Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala loves you and I, we don't need anybody else's love. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala instill our hearts with the love of Allah and His Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala allow us to practice upon the Quran and Hadith. Ameen wa akhiru da'wana alhamdulillahi rabbil alameen.
الحمد لله الذي بعث إلينا نبيه ومصطفاه وشرح صدره واجتباه وأشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وأشهد أن سيدنا ونبينا محمد رسول الله صلى الله وسلم وبارك عليه وعلى آله وصحبه ومن والاه. أما بعد، فأوصيكم عباد الله ونفسي بتقوى الله عز وجل. قال جل في علا: يا أيها الذين آمنوا اتقوا الله وآمنوا برسوله يؤتكم كفلين من رحمته ويجعل لكم نورا تمشون به ويغفر لكم. أيها المؤمنون، سورة عظيمة آياتها ثمانية نزلت على النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم بمكة المكرمة بعد 11 سورة، هي من السور الست المستهلة بالاستفهام. إنها سورة الشرح التي كانت تسلية لقلب نبينا عليه الصلاة والسلام وبيانا لمكانته ورفعة لشأنه، فخاطبه بها ربه تعالى خطاب تودد وإكرام وتلطف وامتنان: ألم نشرح لك صدرك. بأبي هو وأمي صلى الله عليه وسلم، لقد شرح الله تعالى صدره فملأه رحمة ومحبة وعطفا وشفقة، فكان قلبه صلى الله عليه وسلم سمحا سليما وخلقه راقيا كريما، يسامح المسيء ويتجاوز عن المخطئ ولا يحمل ضغينة ولا بغضة، بل يعفو ويصفح. ووقاه ربه سبحانه شر الذنوب والأوزار، قال سبحانه: ووضعنا عنك وزرك الذي أنقض ظهرك. أيها المحبون للنبي صلى الله عليه وسلم، لقد أعلى ربنا تعالى ذكر نبيه صلى الله عليه وسلم في العالمين ورفع مقامه في عليين، قال تبارك وتعالى: ورفعنا لك ذكرك. فقلوب المؤمنين عامرة بحبه، وألسنتهم معطرة بذكره، وشفاههم لاهجة بالصلاة والسلام عليه. فليس خطيب يخطب، ولا مصل يتشهد، ولا مؤذن يؤذن، إلا يقول: أشهد أن لا إله إلا الله، أشهد أن محمد رسول الله. وما أصدق قول الشاعر: وضم الإله اسم النبي مع اسمي، إذا قال في الخمس المؤذن أشهد. فذكره صلى الله عليه وسلم باق إلى يوم القيامة. فاللهم إنا نشهد أنك أنت الله وأن سيدنا محمد رسول الله، فأكرمنا بشفاعته واملأ قلوبنا بمحبته وامنن علينا بمرافقته. آمين. أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم. ورفعنا لك ذكرك. أقول قولي هذا وأستغفر الله لي ولكم ولسائر المسلمين من كل ذنب وخطيئة، فاستغفروه إنه هو الغفور الرحيم. الحمد لله حق حمده، والصلاة والسلام على نبيه وعبده وعلى آله وصحبه ومن تبع هديه من بعده. أما بعد، فيا عباد الله، من المبادئ التي أكدت عليها سورة الشرح قيام التفاؤل والظن الحسن، فكل شدة وعسر يتبعها فرج ويسر. فيا من أصابته الهموم وتكاثرت عليه الأحزان وبلغ منه اليأس مبلغه، ما بالك بأمر أكده الله تعالى وكرره، فقال سبحانه: فإن مع العسر يسرا، إن مع العسر يسرا. فثق بوعد ربه وكن على يقين بأنه لن يغلب عسر يسرين. لا تقنط من روح الله، وأبشر بفرج من الله تزول به آلامك وتتحقق معه آمالك، فلعل الله يتبع العسر الذي تعرفه يسرا لا تدركه. ولله در القائل: ولرب نازلة يضيق بها الفتى ذرعا وعند الله منها المخرج. وفي ختام سورة الشرح يقول الله تبارك وتعالى لنبيه عليه الصلاة والسلام: فإذا فرغت فانصب وإلى ربك فارغب، أي إذا فرغت من أمر دنياك فارغب إلى مولاك. قف بين يديه داعيا وله مناجيا ولفضله راجيا، فإنه خير من سئل وأكرم من أعطى. هذا، وصل اللهم وسلم وبارك على سيدنا ونبينا محمد، من في الصلاة عليه انشراح الصدور وزوال الهموم ومغفرة الذنوب، وعلى آله وصحبه أجمعين. ورضى اللهم عن أبي بكر وعمر وعثمان وعلي وعن سائر الصحابة الأكرمين ومن تبعهم بإحسان إلى يوم الدين. اللهم اشرح صدورنا ويسر أمورنا وأسعد قلوبنا واغفر ذنوبنا وثقل موازيننا. اللهم اجعلنا بك مؤمنين ولك عابدين وإليك منيبين وبهدي نبيك مقتدين وبوالدينا بارين، وارحمهم كما ربونا صغارا يا أرحم الراحمين. ربنا ما سألناك من خير فأعطنا، وما قصرت عنه دعواتنا من الخيرات فبلغنا، إنك أنت الوهاب. اللهم ارحم المسلمين والمسلمات والمؤمنين والمؤمنات، الأحياء منهم والأموات. اللهم انصر الإسلام والمسلمين، اللهم انصر من نصر الإسلام والمسلمين واجعلنا منهم، واخذل من خذل الإسلام والمسلمين ولا تجعلنا منهم ولا معهم. عباد الله، رحمكم الله، إن الله يأمر بالعدل والإحسان وإيتاء ذي القربى وينهى عن الفحشاء والمنكر والبغي يعظكم لعلكم تذكرون. اذكروا الله تعالى يذكركم، وادعوه يستجب لكم، ولذكر الله تعالى أكبر، والله يعلم ما تصنعون. أقيموا الصلاة.
الله أكبر، الله أكبر، أشهد أن لا إله إلا الله، أشهد أن محمد رسول الله، حي على الصلاة، حي على الفلاح، قد قامت الصلاة، قد قامت الصلاة. الله أكبر، الله أكبر، لا إله إلا الله.
سووا واعتدلوا، سووا صفوفكم، please make sure lines are straight, no gaps in between, please stand shoulder to shoulder. الله أكبر. الحمد لله رب العالمين، الرحمن الرحيم، مالك يوم الدين، إياك نعبد وإياك نستعين، اهدنا الصراط المستقيم، صراط الذين أنعمت عليهم غير المغضوب عليهم ولا الضالين. والضحى والليل إذا سجى، ما ودعك ربك وما قلى، وللآخرة خير لك من الأولى، ولسوف يعطيك ربك فترضى، ألم يجدك يتيما فآوى، ووجدك ضالا فهدى، ووجدك عائلا فأغنى، فأما اليتيم فلا تقهر، وأما السائل فلا تنهر، وأما بنعمة ربك فحدث. الله أكبر. سمع الله لمن حمده الله أكبر الله أكبر الله أكبر الله أكبر الحمد لله رب العالمين الرحمن الرحيم مالك يوم الدين إياك نعبد وإياك نستعين اهدنا الصراط المستقيم صراط الذين أنعمت عليهم غير المغضوب عليهم ولا الضالين ألم نشرح لك صدرك ووضعنا عنك وزرك الذي أنقض ظهرك ورفعنا لك ذكرك فإن مع العسر يسرا إن مع العسر يسرا فإذا فرغت فانصب وإلى ربك فارغب الله أكبر سمع الله لمن حمده الله أكبر الله أكبر الله أكبر الله أكبر السلام عليكم ورحمة الله السلام عليكم ورحمة الله
الحمد لله رب العالمين والعاقبة للمتقين والصلاة والسلام على سيدنا محمد وعلى آله وصحبه أجمعين ربنا ظلمنا أنفسنا وإن لم تغفر لنا وترحمنا لنكونن من الخاسرين ربنا اغفر لنا ذنوبنا وكفر عنا سيئاتنا وتوفنا مع الأبرار اللهم إنا نسألك الهدى والتقوى والعفاف والغنى اللهم إنا نسألك رضاك والجنة ونعوذ بك من سخطك وغضبك والنار ربنا آتنا في الدنيا حسنة وفي الآخرة حسنة وقنا عذاب النار ربنا تقبل منا إنك أنت السميع العليم وتب علينا يا مولانا إنك أنت التواب الرحيم وصلى الله تبارك وتعالى على خير خلقه سيدنا محمد وعلى آله وصحبه أجمعين برحمتك